We know that many successful movie characters have an arch nemesis that corresponds to them. This pattern seems to apply quite well in today's animal kingdom. For instance, there's the age-old rivalry between Arachnida and Insecta, or the endless struggle between cartilaginous fish and bony fish. However, I believe that the most famous pair of adversaries in the entire history of animal evolution is undoubtedly Synapsida and Sauropsida. In the Synapsida branch, later evolving into mammals, including humans, I will refer to them as beasts. As for the Sauropsida branch, it evolved into various dinosaurs, pterosaurs, marine reptiles, including today's crocodiles, lizards, turtles, and so on, so I will call them dragons. The so-called battle for dragon and beast refers to the competition between these two evolutionary branches that has persisted for 300 million years. The story of the battle for dragon and beast begins over 300 million years ago, in the Carboniferous period. As I mentioned in previous videos, the Carboniferous was the era of Temnospondyli, a group of amphibians that exerted significant dominance, pushing many other terrestrial vertebrates to the fringes of ecological niches. Ultimately, they forced the emergence of a group of vertebrates specialized for arid environments, known as reptiliomorpha. This evolutionary branch rapidly developed a range of survival adaptations, such as waterproof keratinized skin covering their bodies and developing fingertips on their limbs. During this time, several regional rulers emerged, but I want to highlight two of them, one called Hylonomus and the other called Archaeothyrus. They represent the earliest known ancestors of dragons and beasts. Although they may have looked similar in appearance, their descendants took vastly different evolutionary paths. Let's start with dragons. I have to say that Sauropsida, even though they had formidable strength, tended to be overly cautious. They wouldn't strike without being fully prepared, and this, in turn, gave opportunities to our evolutionary branch, the beasts Synapsida. By the end of the Carboniferous period, while dragons were still leveling up and acquiring equipment in the starter zone, our beast ancestors had already started to seize the initiative. This allowed beasts to become the dominant force in the Permian period. However, all of this came at a cost. The cost was that, because all equipment only needed to be roughly usable, so it left behind many potential problems. Later on, our ancestors became pitiful creatures beneath the feet of dinosaurs, and this misfortune was sown from here. For example, our skin still contained glands, just like our amphibian ancestors, and our ability to retain water was inadequate. Additionally, Synapsida excreted nitrogenous waste by converting it into urea, as urea is soluble in water, and thus excretion of nitrogenous waste required urination, wasting precious water. Furthermore, the metabolic waste, urea, produced by embryos would dissolve in the eggs produced by Synapsida, making the embryos vulnerable to their own waste, potentially poisoning them. So, in a sense, the amniotic eggs of Synapsida could only be considered semi-finished products. In other aspects, our ancestral groups also exhibited a make-do with what you have attitude. For instance, some Synapsida turned to a herbivorous diet. However, during those times, bacteria capable of aiding in cellulose digestion in the intestines of vertebrates might not have evolved yet. So what to do? The Edaphosauridae family chose to strengthen their teeth for better chewing and slower digestion. While this is a conventional evolutionary adaptation, what's unconventional is how they shaped their teeth. If that wasn't enough, they extended their intestines, eventually creating these large-bellied creatures. So, it turns out that going vegetarian might not necessarily help you lose weight. Additionally, there's Ophiuchodon, and to this day, we still don't know why these creatures developed such enormous mouths. Furthermore, there were some that faced challenges in terms of adaptation, like the Varanopidae. They maintained their ancestral forms and lifestyles for an extended period. However, as rulers of their time, they undoubtedly had top-tier predators, and that's where the Sphenacodontia came in. The renowned Dimetrodon was born within this evolutionary branch. It was from this point that the beasts gradually began to upgrade their equipment, marking the first significant body revolution for the beasts. Dimetrodon had a variety of different shaped teeth in its mouth, marking the first significant bodily breakthrough in the evolutionary history of Synapsida tooth differentiation. The front pointed teeth were responsible for inflicting damage, while the smaller teeth with serrated edges towards the rear efficiently cut food. This specialization in tooth morphology, with clearly defined roles, would be further developed by the descendants of beasts over the next hundreds of millions of years. Additionally, according to trace fossil studies, Dimetrodon could lift its abdomen and move its body using all four limbs. In simpler terms, it could run and jump. Although by today's standards, these features might seem like basic skills for carnivores, nearly 300 million years ago, during the early Permian period, the majority of terrestrial vertebrates still moved with their bellies on the ground. In such an environment, Dimetrodon truly stood out as a king. Dimetrodon's most famous feature is undoubtedly its incredibly cool-looking neural spine sail on its back. Studying this neural spine sail has consumed quite a few brain cells of paleontologists. Initially, it was speculated to be used for regulating body temperature. However, after decades of research, people gradually realized that this neural spine sail was more likely used for display. However, just as these early Synapsida animals were enjoying their glory, their reign came to an abrupt end. Around 273 million years ago, there was a major ecological crisis on the supercontinent of Pangaea, known as the Olsen's extinction event. To this day, there is ongoing debate about whether this event was caused by natural disasters or if the overwhelming dominance of the Synapsida disrupted the global ecological balance, ultimately leading to their downfall. In any case, following this event, most of the bizarre and early Synapsidae gradually faded from the stage of history. However, a descendant of the Sphenacodontia managed to survive and initiated the second dynasty of beasts, known as Sauropsida. These animals were entirely different in style from their ancestors. I can't help but wonder if academic conferences in this field were particularly intriguing. In any case, these Sauropsida animals took over the dominance from the early Synapsida. They largely inherited the kind of remarkable adaptations seen in creatures like Dimetrodon, especially when it came to their teeth. Their teeth had started to show differentiation similar to our modern counterparts incisors, canines, and molars. The canines, in particular, made significant leaps during this period, evolving into a wide array of dazzling new skills. Some of the herbivorous Sauropsida, like Dinosaurs, transformed their canines into tools for digging up roots, much like today's wild boars. Others turned their canines into weapons for combat against their own kind, like Tiarajuden's Eccentricus, akin to modern-day water deer. However, the Gorgonopsia were the true masters when it came to developing the most potent use of canines, which I would like to call the saber-toothed hunting style. In simple terms, they used their dagger-like saber teeth to swiftly sever the carotid arteries, causing lethal damage to their prey. This technique, as the most efficient hunting skill of beasts for taking down large animals, was independently developed over hundreds of millions of years and can be considered a classic among classics. This innovation led to the emergence of a new generation of large predators within the Gorgonopsia family. Among them, the largest in size was Inostroncivia, which was even bigger than today's Siberian tiger. They were the saber-toothed tigers of their time, hunting the largest prey on the supercontinent of Pangaea. Furthermore, the Olsen's extinction event had a devastating impact on Temnospondyli and other Reptiliomorpha. They essentially lost any chance of challenging the dominance of the beasts after this catastrophic event. At this moment, after lying dormant for 25 million years, Sauropsida emerged from the starter zone, preparing to challenge the dominion of the beasts. These dragons had superior water-retaining abilities and more developed amniotic eggs compared to the beasts. While breaking the beasts' monopoly was still challenging, it didn't stop them from achieving local victories on smaller battlefields. For example, Parasaurus evolved into a new generation of large herbivores and was once one of the largest herbivores at the end of the Permian period. Additionally, there was Mesosaurus, which used its fine teeth to filter small animals from the water, making it one of the earliest amniotes to return to aquatic life. Some of these Sauropsida developed interesting skills, like Eudibamus, which was among the earliest to learn bipedal upright walking. Others looked to the skies. Coelurosaurus, for instance, could spread membranes on both sides of its body and glide between treetops. However, unexpectedly, around 260 million years ago, beasts embarked on their second bodily revolution. The result of this revolution was Eutheriodontia, which can be summarized as they grew fur and became more powerful. As previously mentioned, the skin of beasts was rather primitive, with numerous glands prone to losing moisture. Unable to eliminate this drawback, Eutheriodontia turned these glands into sweat glands, allowing them to regulate their body temperature effectively. At the same time, they evolved fur to retain body heat. Consequently, Eutheriodontia acquired a groundbreaking passive skill, a constant body temperature. Additionally, Eutheriodontia evolved a structure called the palate. In simpler terms, our ancestors finally had noses. While birds, reptiles, and amphibians have nostrils that connect directly to the mouth, only our branch, the beasts, evolved independent noses and nasal cavities. This development allowed us to breathe while eating, enabling us to chew our food more thoroughly. More importantly, the presence of nasal cavities significantly enhanced our sense of smell. It was from this point that the sensory abilities of the beasts began to gradually surpass those of the dragons. At this moment, dragons were still hiding their true power. While beasts were undergoing their second bodily revolution, a creature called Archosaurus appeared in a region equivalent to modern-day Poland. This creature was the true ace of the dragons. But all of this became inconsequential. Around 260 million years ago, a massive volcano erupted near what is now the vicinity of Mount Emei in China. The skies darkened, and the world was plunged into darkness. The pall of death hung over much of the supercontinent of Pangaea. However, this was just the beginning. In a region that would later be known as Siberia, molten magma deep within the earth continued to simmer. The great extinction was approaching, and the battle for dragon and beast remained undecided. Ultimately, who would emerge victorious? This is Ancient Discovery. See you next episode, The Battle for Dragon and Beast.